Ritu, thanks very much for that. Let's focus back on market fundamentals. Pratik Agarwal is business head and CIO at ASK Investment Managers, somebody who's been in the market for a long, long time. Pratik, it's been a while. Thanks very much for being back here on CNBC TV 18. Pratik, let's just talk first about, you know, the little wobble we've seen overnight and the consequent correction we are seeing here today. I mean, it's just a small pullback in the context of the massive move we've seen so far. Any thoughts very near term? What is likely to happen?
See, I do believe if we get a correction, it will be bought into. You know, there are a few things to support this. When we got in the correction, you know, this was the first time when we saw retail Indian investor come in to the market in a big force. And they are today, you know, making a lot of money. Economy is recovering, interest rates are low, you know, and we have this huge investor class which is in the money. So we do believe any sharp correction at this juncture, you know, unless it is accompanied by a news item which is as severe, would be bought into, and the correction should prove shallow. Frankly, we do expect the market to regain its earlier highs over the next few months. In this fiscal, given the fact that economy is recovering, we do expect quarter four to show a growth over quarter four of last year, and interest rates are low.
Yeah, I mean, interest rates are low, but the second part about the economy recovering, how sure are you that, I mean, forget about FY21, let's talk about FY22 briefly, if you can sort of lay out your thoughts. Why do you think there will be a sharp recovery?
So, FY22 in terms of EPS for the index, you know, if we end FY21 at somewhere around 460, 470 range, FY22 should be 560, 570 at the minimum. If you look at the street estimates today, they are 650 odds, you know, but yes, a lot of it driven by commodity cyclicals and so on. And only time will tell whether that would sustain. But still, you know, a small point is FY22 numbers are significantly over FY20 pre-COVID numbers. And hence, we do believe, you know, markets will start to focus on that as we go forward. Yes, the sectoral composition may be different. There are new winners, there are new sectors which are doing relatively better in the marketplace, in the economy. They are leading, frankly, the up move, and we believe that could sustain, but overall the index could also you know, go up to its earlier highs sooner than later.
Okay, markets headed higher, back to its all-time highs. Dips should be bought into. Pratik, morning. This is Reema here. So, sectorally, how would you position your portfolio now?
So, we are high-quality and high-growth investors. We like the confluence of these two factors in our investing. In this space, we believe strong compounded growth, not one period, but multi-year growth would be seen in spaces like insurance, chronic pharmaceuticals, diagnostic chains, for example, specialty chemical, telecom and technology, maybe including IT services. So these are spaces that we believe could do very well. Amongst these cyclicals, we like autos. Especially city-centric autos, and we do believe two-wheelers could be the way for Indians to attain social distancing in the post-COVID world. So that these are the spaces that we believe will deliver what we seek in the marketplace.
Pratik, you also like retail, the high-yielding business. Now, you don't see a permanent impact to retail, at least for the next 2 years, as this COVID pandemic plays out. And also your thoughts on NBFCs. They were already in a weak position prior to the COVID, and then this pandemic has not helped. most companies are suffering a lot more. How would you pick your stocks in retail and NBFCs? Which are the pockets that you would like? And what is the long-term picture or just the medium-term picture for these two?
Retail NBFCs is something that we like, as also retail focused banks, entities which have raised monies in the recent past and are today much stronger position versus the competition in the same space. So this is something to be recognized. You know, this is a situation where everybody is getting impacted, but the guys who are impacted less will emerge winners in the post-COVID marketplace. And if you look at how the market is behaving, these are entities which are dropping less versus the others in the same space. We do believe that in a period wherein liquidity is no longer a constraint for the better run NBFCs, we are not going out for badly run NBFCs or infrastructure NBFCs, real estate NBFCs. That's not our cup of tea. Otherwise, retail-focused NBFCs in spaces like vehicle finance, in spaces like the low-cost housing, gold finance, even microfinance are spaces that we like. Many of them are seeing a strong recovery in collections. Gold finance actually never had a problem. Microfinance is coming back strongly. So we like this space. This is where ROEs can be high. They are sustained to be high for a length of time. Yes, there is a hiccup in 1 year on account of COVID, but we do believe it will normalize sooner than later. In a period of high liquidity, the big advantage that the banks have of the branch network and being able to collect deposits can hurt on the other side. You know, you get deposit, but you can't lend commensurately. So NBFCs in such a situation are very nicely positioned.
Pratik, this issue may be transient, but the Supreme Court yesterday said that no account should be classified as NPA till it decides on the interest on interest matter. Do you think it is significant the date that they've given us, the next hearing is the 10th of September. Now we don't know, it may get pushed more. So in that context, what happens? Q2 results kind of become irrelevant, don't they?
Yeah, so in Q2 results, you will not have NPA recognition. While we do believe lenders would continue to provide, so you may not have NPA, but nobody stops you from being more prudent and providing more. So you will see provision coverage ratios move up. So that is how it is. I really don't know why. Something like this should be looked at by the Supreme Court. It should be looked at by the regulators. This is something new that we are looking at. But that said, in the whole space, these shorter duration loan guys are less impacted. The longer duration loan guys are more impacted. If you're looking at retail, barring the small cheaper housing lenders where yes the duration of loans is longer, other spaces, for example vehicle finance, gold finance, consumer durable finance, two-wheeler finance are all short duration loans, 3 months to 3 year kind of a period, and their interest on interest may not impact as much.
Pratik, do you own Page Industries?
Yes, we do.
Okay. I don't want to talk about the stock and what it may do, bit about this news flow about ethics organization writing to the pension fund of Norway, the government pension fund of Norway, essentially asking them that there are ethics violations of the company. The company, of course, management on the con call after the results strongly denied this. So they've given their rebuttal. How would you look at this?
So they are within the laws of the land. They are amongst the best in the space by the standards of overseas entities. I really don't know what kind of due diligence they did and what were the shortcomings they saw. So, but I do believe the company has provided their response to both the newspapers and the entity itself. So let the space develop. Does it impact business in India? No. They are not exporters. They cater to the subcontinent. So the business outlook doesn't get impacted at all, and that is what we as investors look at.
It's a pleasure speaking with you. Thanks so much for joining in. That's Prateek Agarwal of ASK Investment Advisors, betting bullish on the markets. Here's what we'll do. We'll slip into a very short break. But if you want to find